against humanity committed in Sri Lanka. On another matter, the ghost of a former corrupt Liberal New South Wales Premier again haunts Macquarie Street in Sydney. I spoke last week about the breakdown in standards and decency in the New South Wales Liberal National Government and how in many areas they mirror the reign of the disgraced Liberal leader Robert Askin. The latest area where we see this is the Baird government's local government amalgamation push. This is a story of manipulation and dishonesty with a fancy PR title of Fit for the Future. At the heart of this plan is the removal of residents' rights to have a say in their community. The winner here, like so much this government undertakes, are corporate businesses. Amalgamations by choice are not what I am talking about. The problem is the forced amalgamations and the amalgamations by trickery. If the mass amalgamations of local councils that the Baird government is pushing do eventuate, New South Wales will become even more of a developer's paradise, where approvals are given with little input from locals, building certification is so poor lives can be put at risk, and worker on-the-job safety is weakened, all to assist construction companies to cut corners to increase their profits. Rather than the government's heavy-handed scare tactics of amalgamate or suffer, we should be assisting our local councils to deliver quality services, democratic consultation and needed infrastructure. Local government is where our decision makers are most closely connected to the community. Together, they should be well placed to make decisions on services, planning and development. Forced amalgamation stands to alienate this level of government from local communities. Size matters, and the average size of councils in New South Wales is already well above the global standard. The council average in New South Wales is 48,490. In OECD countries, the average population size per local government in metropolitan areas is just over 27,000. So New South Wales councils are already well above this average size. An increase in the size of councils would result in the communities in these local government areas having a reduced voice due to the reduced representation that comes with amalgamated councils. The Greens support reforms that improve the financial sustainability of local councils, but there is no justification for forcing amalgamations on financially struggling councils. Merging two or even three councils that are in financial difficulties only expands the problem. Liberal dirty tactics on amalgamations are on display at the Hills Shire Council, where misleading information is being used to effectively push-poll a dodgy survey. The Liberal Council is distributing highly misleading material to its residents to support the pro-amalgamation agenda. This material, which directs residents to a biased online survey, presents participants with three options, but all options are for one form of amalgamation or another. Residents are not given the option of remaining a standalone council in its current borders. Not only does the online survey not provide residents with the option to select to retain council, also there is no requirement for the person filling in the survey to identify themselves, so it is not possible to determine if there are repeat votes. The survey is clearly open to manipulation. What a waste of public money and ratepayers' money. Now, for the record, this is in Liberal Party heartland. Hillshire Council is solidly controlled by the Liberals. 9 out of 12 are Liberal councillors. Alex Hawke is the federal MP, and the state MP, and interestingly, the Minister for Finance, is Dominic Perrottet. I introduce this speech tonight by equating the current New South Wales Liberal government with its forerunner, the corrupt Askin government. I am not accusing any minister of picking up brown paper bags of money, but the levels of dishonesty to get their favoured outcome of a larger, less democratic council where residents have few options to have a say in their community is a clear example of a corrupt practice as certain corporate interests will benefit. The government's amalgamation campaign is also another example to get clover. The get clover obsession that has become an unhealthy occupation of the Baird government. First off, the Liberal National Government engineered the voting system for Sydney City Council to give corporations two votes for a corporation, not for a person. And now they are looking to merge Sydney City Council with surrounding councils in the east to give and this would give local Liberals a leg up and even a better chance of taking control of the jewel in the city crown, the Lord Mayor, Lord Mayor's position. Despite the heavy hand of amalgamate now or else approach, this Conservative government, most local government councils in New South Wales of all political persuasions are successfully resisting the New South Wales government's fit for the future forced amalgamations agendas. But interestingly, there is an odd exception. Labor and Liberal councils on Leichhardt Council voted together for amalgamation with Ashfield and Canada Bay councils, despite growing concern about what this will mean. Greens Mayor Rochelle Porteous has set out how this Labor-Liberal unity ticket betrays a community which has expressed a strong wish to stay separate. The outcome of the Fit for the Future plan is in the balance as communities organise to save their local councils. Meanwhile, Liberal concern about the future of local council government in New South Wales has been further exposed by their federal colleagues. It was in last year's budget that delivered a $1 billion cut in infrastructure funding for local government. On another matter, when I visited Alice Springs earlier this year, I witnessed apartheid. The first time was outside a local bottle shop. I was with colleagues from the Alice Springs Greens walking across town to the venue for our evening event. As we cut through a shopping centre, we saw the Northern Territory apartheid laws in action. Two men were stopped by police just as they came out of the shopping centre's bottle shop. I was with my colleague, Greens member and former federal candidate Barbara Shaw. Quite an argument ensued between the men and the police. The officer told the men they knew the rules. The men objected to how they were being treated and how it was unfair. The police officer told one of the men who had bought the alcohol that if he could bring back proof of where he lived and if it complied, he would give him back his drinks. While this exchange played out, many non-Aboriginal customers left the bottle shop with numerous alcoholic purchases. These people were not stopped or questioned. There are 11 bottle shops in Alice, and a police officer is stationed outside each one while they are open for business. If an Aboriginal person comes out with alcoholic drinks, the officer asks them for identity, and if they cannot show proof of who they are and that they live in a location where they can drink alcohol, their purchases are taken from them. Barbara Shaw told me how people are put on APOs, alcohol protection orders. If they are caught three times with alcohol, the law deems they should not have. Then they have to go for mandatory treatment. Many locals I met called Alice a police town. The police activities outside bottle shops occur as part of Operation Leyland, which comes under Stronger Futures legislation as successor to the Northern Territory National Emergency Response. The legislation allows police to stop and search people and confiscate their alcohol if there is a reasonable suspicion that alcohol will be taken to a restricted area. Operation Leyland bases its reasonable suspicion on the colour of the purchaser's skin. Racial profiling and Aboriginal people are routinely stopped. Aboriginal people I met spoke of their concerns that these actions are not about reducing harm and providing a safe environment. The NTER gave police powers to enter Aboriginal homes without a warrant on the suspicion that there was alcohol inside. This resulted in police raids on town camps, terrifying residents and compounding feelings of social alienation. Many Aboriginal people I met in Alice told me they see these police activities as a means of disempowering Aboriginal communities. They told me how the authorities consistently refuse to seriously engage with Aboriginal leaders to empower communities to drive their own solutions. Stronger Future actually allows for the development of alcohol management plans by individual communities. However, despite extensive efforts from Aboriginal peoples to negotiate such plans, there has been little movement. Barbara Shaw said Aboriginal people can come up with their own solutions for their own problems. That's why we, referring to the Mount Nancy Town Camp, worked on our alcohol management plan. This has never been supported by the Northern Territory government and has never been supported by the federal government. Our time and effort has been wasted. Money has been wasted to recreate the wheel. I do congratulate the Intervention Rollback Action Group, the Northern Territory Greens and the many other organisations working to end the abuse and discrimination of Aboriginal people and working to promote self-determination so communities can deal with the social problems they face. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you.